Okay, good evening, everyone. Nosoi dda, chroeso I gerddi Safai. Good evening, welcome to Safai Gardens. Yes, I'm here in the Museum of Welsh Cricket here at the stadium where we're delighted to be able to welcome back school children into the indoor school and others. And we're hoping that after Christmas, we'll be able to have a resumption of the museum talks in person here in the museum. But for this evening, it's with great pleasure that we are going to be looking at an era or two decades, which I think it must be said might not necessarily be the greatest in Glamorgan's history, but certainly the 1970s and the 1980s had a lot for us to talk about and a lot for us to look back very fondly on. I'm delighted to be able to welcome to the talk this evening two former Glamorgan players. We are going to be joined by a third just after 8 o'clock. Matthew Maynard will be joining us, obviously, for the last 10 days or so. He's been welly man walking. And he's now on holiday with his wife in Northern England. But Matt will be joining us just the turn of 8 o'clock. But it's a great pleasure to have on the call this evening someone who was a Glamorgan star during the 1980s and again during the 1990s. Of course, I'm talking about Hugh Morris. Good evening, Hugh.
Good evening, Andrew. And good evening, everybody. It's nice to see so many people here.
Great. And also on the call this evening, someone else who was a star during the 1970s and someone who we will, in fact, all being well, if I can get the video film working, we're actually going to be seeing in batting action in that wonderful game at Lord's, the Gillette Cup of 1977. And yes, that's six. So I'm talking, of course, about Mike Llewellyn. Good evening, Mike.
Good evening, Andrew. Good evening, everyone. Hope you're all okay.
Great. And so nice to have you on the call this evening. And as the nights draw in, as the rugby internationals start, as people continue to drop out of Strictly Come Dancing, it's nice, of course, for us to be fondly looking back on great summer days. Well, we're going to... Whoops, let me just get this going again. We're going to be starting with a series of images. Here we go. Starting, of course, way back at the end of the 1960s. This is the story that we finished on back in March, the last of our talks, which was when we were celebrating Glamorgan winning the county championship. And you may remember at the end of the 1969 season, Prince Charles sent an email to Tony Lewis and the victorious team, and he said, "Do it again next year." Well, unfortunately, Tony and the team failed those regal instructions, but they did finish second. And the 1970 season saw a number of outstanding performances. But in particular, for Alan Jones, the gentleman, of course, there on the right-hand side, for Alan Jones, 1970 meant that he was able to wear, for the one and only time, the England cap. Now, Mike, as someone who was... brought up under the tutelage of Alan Jones. Mike, perhaps you could start off this evening just by talking about Alan as a great batsman. You shared one thing, of course, in common. You were both left-handers. So talk me through your memories of Alan.
Well, I can always remember Alan, obviously watching down at St. Helens. And he was a legend, you know, at the time. And he was always, what I found about Alan, he's always down to earth, along with his brother Ivion. And he was a tremendous player. And of course, in those days, never used to wear a helmet or much any body armor at all, apart from pads and a thigh pad and your gloves. But I can always remember him. He was meticulous, always well-dressed, and a superb player. And it was great to look up to him as I started. I signed my first professional forms in 69 and was up at Lord's when he actually made his debut against the rest of the world. But from there on in, you could always go to Alan and ask him his advice and take everything on board. And he would talk to you, he'd sit down, and he always had time for everyone, not only the younger element, but anybody that came on to him.
Were you there then, or maybe what I should say is, what were you doing when Alan there was walking out with Brian Luckers to open the batting at Lord's? It's quite a fearsome attack, Mike Proctor and co, but what were you doing at Lord's?
Well, I was on the MCC staff at Lord's, along with the coach of the MCC Young Professionals was, of course, Len Munster. Now, Len obviously played for Glamorgan when they won the championship the first time in 1948. So the squad of young cricketers, and there was around about 30 to 40 young cricketers that came from various counties and so forth. And everybody was delighted that a Welshman was actually going to be playing for England, as it was. And when Alan and Brian Luckers came out, it was a tremendous ovation. And I'm not sure if it was just for the fact that they were coming out to bat or because it was Alan being Welsh and representing Wales at Lord's against the rest of the world.
Yeah, a great day for Alan. And of course, the 1970 season had started in some style, with the Glamorgan team celebrating their championship's success in 69 by actually going on an overseas tour. I think Don Shepherd once told me the previous overseas tour had been going on the ferry to the Isle of Wight to play a match at Cowes against Hampshire in 1962. But here was Glamorgan, sponsored by Risler, on a tour which Peter Walker had organised. And there in the West Indies, on a variety of pitches, they were able to hone their skills ahead of the 1970 season. We can see in the back row of the photo there, Glamorgan's overseas star, Brian Davis, who was able to welcome his county colleagues to his home soil. Also there on the back row is Jeff Jones. And Jeff, of course, had been struck down with injury. So there you were as a young player, having possibly one of the greatest left-arm quick bowlers Glamorgan has ever produced. Did you ever face Jeff at all?
As a matter of fact, I didn't. I mean, Jeff's injury was tragic, absolutely tragic, because he was in full flow, superb bowler. And obviously, being left-arm, he caused major problems, with batsmen all around the world. And it's such a sad shame that this happened to him. But it was only years and years later, when sort of basically finished and playing some club cricket, that Jeff was playing for Darwin. That's the only time I think I ever played against Jeff, but he was still rapid then, and he let you know that who he was the other side. So you the duck and dive from him even then, and he'd passed his greatness as it was. But it is so sad to see Jeff, falling away, and he just couldn't bowl. It's tragic.
Yeah, and I'm sure that several of you know that there will be a function at the Towers Hotel, which the Balconeers are organising in November. And it is also, as well as looking back on the wonderful history that Glamorgan County Cricket Club has, we're also going to be celebrating as well, Jeff being 80 not out. Well, moving on to the next image, if I can get the equipment working. Here we are then, the Glamorgan side of the squad, back at Sophia Gardens for 1971. And really a new era in Glamorgan. Several of the people there on the front row, their careers sadly starting to come to an end. But there is a gentleman on the on this next image who was responsible, of course, for grooming the next generation. This image here is the Glamorgan under 25 team from the early 1970s. The TCCB, the Test and County Cricket Board, had introduced a new competition, a limited over competition, and counties were able to field under an under 25 team, as we'll hear from Hugh a little bit later on. Glamorgan did really well in that competition in the early 1980s, and several of the county's stars were able to hone their skills. But here we are, Mike, I can see you on the front row there, looking very dapper. And I can see also on the front row from left to right, Gwyn Richards, Jeff Ellis, John Hopkins or Ponty. We can see Arthur Francis on the extreme right, and sat in the middle, Mike, next to you, the man who was leading the Glamorgan under 25 team then, someone who was a fine footballer as well as a fine cricketer, Graham Reynolds. And on the back row as well, left to right, we can see Clive Davis, Barry Lloyd, Peter Crowther, Bob Dudley Jones, Stuart Harrison, Kenny Francis, who I had the pleasure of facing once playing Parks cricket here in Cardiff, and also Kim Davis. But the man I'm talking about in terms of grooming the next generation is Phil Clift. Now, Hugh, I'll just bring you in on the conversation now, because I know Phil was still around in the early 1980s and the late 1970s when your illustrious career began. Perhaps you could just say a few words about Phil and the work he did in bringing in the new generation.
Yeah, I mean, first and foremost, Phil was a real gentleman. He was somebody that that warmly welcomed me to the club as a very young player. And, you know, he had a passion for developing local talent. He was very successful at doing it. He had enormous respect from all the players, whether they were the younger generation or the older generation. And, you know, at that stage, he was alongside the, you know, the likes of Wilf Willer was Mr. Glamorgan Cricket. And, you know, I can't think of anyone better to have nurtured the talent than Phil at that time.
Absolutely. Mike, your memories of Phil?
Oh, I've got some great memories of Phil. Unbelievable. Because when I made my debut in 1970, I'd been playing with the second team, and we'd gone up to Worcester, but we'd been away for nearly a fortnight with the second team. And he came on to me and he mentioned that I'd been selected to play in the first team at the Parks against Oxford University. So I explained to him, I said, oh, Mr. Clift, I said, I'm really struggling with kit. He said, well, you've got to go because you're playing tomorrow. I said, I haven't got any clean kit, I said. Now, I used to call him Mr. Clift all the time, out of respect. And he said, don't worry. He said, I can help you out there. He said, you can borrow my kit. So he lent me a pair of trousers. Now, Phil was only about 5'6" and I'm 6'1". So the problem being is that our waist sizes were exactly the same, but the length of leg of the trousers, I was going up to make my first class debut with my trousers just below my knees. It was really embarrassing, but great fun, you know, absolutely brilliant. But he was a hell of a character. I got to tell you one story. Again, with the under 25s and the second 11 game, we were playing against Hampshire at Newport. And prior to lunch, we'd dropped about eight catches. nobody could catch the ball, and Phil was absolutely fuming. He said, none of you are going in for lunch. You're all coming out here and you're going to practice catching. So we did. We were out there and we were practically for all the lunchtime. He let us in for a cup of tea and then he came back out and he said, right, you buggers, he said, you go here, there and everywhere. I'm going into first slip. So Phil proceeded into first slip. And the first ball after lunch, the batsman got a thin nick. It went straight to first slip, where Phil proceeded to drop the ball onto the floor. And everybody had to turn around because they were on their knees laughing. Luckily, Phil, and he's a great character, he could see the funny side and he couldn't stop laughing himself. But that was just one little instance. But it's the Sod's Law thing. As soon as he nicked the ball, he went straight to Phil and down it went.
Well, happy days and happy memories of a great man. Sadly, we're going to talk now. And Mike, I know you were actually on the field at the time. We're going to talk about what could have been a very grim and horrendous day, this time in 1971, when the gentleman there crouching at short leg, Roger Davis, was hit on the temple. It was a game between Glamorgan and Warwickshire. I'll just pause because I think some people may have unmuted. So if you can, please mute yourselves so we don't get any feedback. Thank you very much. As I was saying, it was Glamorgan against Warwickshire. Neil Abberley was the Warwickshire batsman. Malcolm Nash, the great left-arm swing bowler, was bowling. And for once, Nashy didn't quite put it in the right place. Roger was crouching as there in the photo. Roger was crouching at short leg, no helmet, no shin pads, no body armour as they do today. And unfortunately, the ball caught him a glancing blow on his temple and down he went. Now, I know, Mike, you were on the field. Talk us through your memories of that day.
Well, it was strange because... as you mentioned, Nashy was bowling from the river end to Neil Abberley, and Neil was very, very good off his legs, and he picked Nashy up. And you also mentioned that there was no helmets in those days or no protective gear, as you said, no shin pads or anything at all like that. It absolutely wellied Roger, and nobody could actually see except that he went down. And none of us had any... I've ever seen anything like this before. But what was quite strange, nobody was trained with any sort of medical help at all. We didn't have a clue what we were doing. And luckily, somebody from the crowd came on, and it started. Strange enough, it just started to rain for no reason at all. It didn't look as if it was going to rain at all day, but it rained and we all went off, what I can remember. And luckily, because Roger turned a terrible, terrible colour, and it was, you know, obviously he was choking to death. And if it wasn't for this gentleman in the crowd, I think he was a doctor, but I'm not sure on that one. He rushed on and he managed to clear the airways. And eventually Roger came down, but he suffered from this for a very, very long time. And if you think of all the great close to the wicket fielders we had over the years, like Peter Walker and Billy Slade and a lot of other great fielders, they were literally within a couple of feet of the batsman who could really, really strike a ball. And I can't understand how... there should have been so many more people, you know, badly hurt because they fielded there and they got hit on their arms and their legs and lots of other places as well. But Roger was so unlucky because he stayed low. He always went low. And unfortunately, Neil caught him at the side of the head, and it was absolutely dreadful. And Tony Lewis, I think, was captain. And in order to sort of show that, you know, we wanted to continue in the same vein and everything else, Tony asked me to go and field at short square leg, which I had to. And of course, you know, being a young man and thinking, I got to go and do this, you know, I got out of this respect in regards to what's happened. But you were just hoping and praying that something like that wouldn't happen to you. But it was an awful day, and it did affect Roger something awful for a long time to come, you know, but he got over it, thank God.
Yeah, thank God. And the gentleman who you referred to running on was actually Dr. Colin Lewis, who was a GP in Pontypridd. I gather the story goes Roger did meet up with him, and apparently he shouldn't have been there at the River End. He'd arrived early to meet up with his wife, and he decided just to watch a bit of cricket, of course, as you would, and little knowing that he would, of course, go on and save Roger's life. Well, what happened then, as I say, after 1971, what happened was we then had a change of the old guard. Some, I know, in the press and at the time, and some have written in their books that perhaps the decision to finish with Don Shepherd and Peter Walker was a little bit too hasty. Decisions, though, were made, and this particular photo is from 1972 at Colwyn Bay. It is actually Don Shepherd's final game for Glamorgan. Very fittingly, Don, of course, a stalwart of 647 county championship matches, his final appearance for Glamorgan on home soil was against Worcestershire in a Sunday league game at Colwyn Bay. And of course, Shep was ever the economical bowler. Peter Walker as well, playing his final game before retiring and becoming such an outstanding broadcaster and journalist. As I say, some people said it was far too soon. Maybe they should have stayed. But it was a changing of the guard. But in 1972, at the same time, Alan Jones going out at Swansea to open the batting with Roy Fredericks, a game against Northamptonshire. Mike, were you playing in that particular game?
Yeah, I was. And I think we were like 300 for no wicket or something like that. And I'm not sure if it is in the days of the 100 overs points applied within the 100 overs. But Bisham Beddy was playing for Northampton. And I think both of the Fredo and Alan got a 100 each, if I'm not mistaken. And we were 300 and odd for no. And we, you know, it was brilliant. You know, these days, now you've got four days to play, they would have batted on and on and on, but they never batted much longer than 100 overs. And so we declared, and if I'm not mistaken, Bisham Beddy bowled us out in the second innings, not for a lot. And I think Northampton won the game. But I was there.
Yeah, it was rather... It rather said a lot about Glamorgan cricket during the 1970s, it must be said, that Roy Fredericks and Alan Jones added 330 for the first wicket. Alan got 105. Roy Fredericks there on the left, the great West Indian opening batsman, made 228. But as you correctly said, Mike, unfortunately, Glamorgan went on to lose the game. But in terms of Glamorgan history, there were a group, of course, of passionate supporters at Swansea, and that was when the Balconeers came into existence. I'm sure more will be said at the Balconeers dinner coming up in November at the Towers, and how a group wanted to recognise the achievements of Alan and Roy, and a collection was made. They went and asked Mr. Wooler. Mr. Wooler course, said yes, and the rest is Balcony's history. Well, Roy Fredericks continued with Glamorgan in 1973, and keeping the overseas flavour going, in the winter of 1972 and 1973, Tony Lewis was chosen as the captain of the England, or maybe I should say the MCC tour to India and Pakistan. And here he is on the right-hand side being introduced by Donald Carr, who was the manager of the tour. There's Tony being introduced to Mrs. Indira Gandhi, the Prime Minister of India. In the second test, Tony managed to achieve a maiden test match 100, and he later led England, as I say, to distinction in the test series as well, which followed against Pakistan. And he returned back to Wales with his stock very, very high. Sadly, of course, 1973, Tony's knees started to play up, and 1974, Tony retired from the first class game. Mike, as someone who played alongside Tony, perhaps you could just say a few words about Tony.
But Tony's a very astute guy, but I think he had weaponry as well to sort of fulfill his ambition when he was captain. He had people to go to, great bowlers, you mentioned Don Shepherd, Peter Walker, Nashi, Tony Cordell, all very, very fine bowlers in their own right. And what he couldn't do very well, and he explained to me, is that we were batting at I think it was Swansea, and he said, "Mike, I can't concentrate. I've got to make a declaration, but I can't make it whilst I'm batting." He said, I've got to get out, he said, so I can go back in and think as regards to the best declaration to manage. And I found it absolutely amazing. So here's Tony Lewis, captain of England, captain of Glamorgan, and explaining to me, I'm thinking how he's got all the tricks of the trade and everything else. He can just really wangle this round in his head and declare what he wanted to declare. And he said, "No, I can't. I've got to get off the field." He said, "And I've got to concentrate," he said, "before I make a declaration." So the next ball, he walked straight past me and off he went. That was amazing. Good gosh.
And an outstanding player, an outstanding journalist, an outstanding broadcaster, and of course, a man we'll talk about a little bit later with Hugh and Matthew, a man, of course, who then came back to Glamorgan in the late 1980s as chairman and helped to draw up a blueprint, which, of course, led to great success in the 1990s. It would be very remiss of me if I didn't mention, of course, that during 1973 as well, England visited Wales for the first time. The first international match staged at St Helens. It was the Prudential Trophy, one-day game between England and New Zealand, July 1973. The idea behind the Prudential Trophy was to take international cricket to grounds which weren't hosting regular international matches. And as well as hosting games, or taking games, I should say, to Swansea, Scarborough also featured on the itinerary that year. Well, you can see there in the centre, Ray Illingworth leading out the England team. From left to right, that's Jeff Arnold, Dennis Amos, John Snow, Ray Illingworth, Tony Gregg, Graham Roop, you can see as well, Frank Hayes and Alan Knott. It was a game which England won. Dennis Amos scored a match-winning 100. Actually, Jeff Boycott was playing and he was outshone by Dennis Amos. And Jeff Arnold and John Snow bowled extremely well in the those unique maritime conditions in that microclimate that Swansea has. But it was a real feather in Glamorgan's cap that in 1 year, 1973, not only did they have an England captain, but Glamorgan also hosted international cricket. And that's quite a major milestone in these series of talks, looking back on the club's 100 years of first-class cricket. We mustn't forget, as I say, 1973, for those two reasons. Well, Roy Fredericks left Glamorgan, and we were talking there about international players of repute. In fact, I gather some Glamorgan committee members went out on a mission to the West Indies to seek a fast bowler. Now, I don't know how apocryphal this story is, but a certain Glamorgan official was watching a game where at one end Michael Holding was bowling, and at the other end, this gentleman, Greg Armstrong. It was Greg Armstrong whose name entered the notebooks and came over, but it has to be said that Greg Armstrong, lovely guy, did rather struggle on the slow Welsh wickets at the time and also had a few run-up problems. I don't know, Mike, if you've got any memories of Greg Armstrong.
Certainly have. As you mentioned, you know, Greg was a really, really lovely guy. But he actually, when he mentioned in about your run-up, it's all about rhythm and everything else. And Greg found it very, very difficult. He used to come off an amazing long run when we first saw him come over. And he used to no ball on a regular basis, purely and simply, as I said, because his rhythm wasn't there. And the coaches tried to work on him as regards to restricting his run up a little bit. And he always found it cold, very, very cold in this country, he said. And I'm in a shirt because the sun is out and he still found it. He had about three pullovers on because he always found it cold. But it's the first time that I've ever seen a quick bowler with his feet or his landing foot with his toes pointing out the front. Actually, nothing protecting his toes at all because he had a lot of bruising on his big toe and little toe. So he cut a hole where his feet, his toes could poke through so you wouldn't get bruising. But he did struggle. I mean, he just couldn't get it right, and it was sad to see, but he was very sharp, and on his day, you know, he could bowl as quick as anyone, and certain counties did find that out. But at the end of the day, it's consistency really that actually marks you down as a great player. And Greg on his day was very, very good, no problems at all. But I think Michael Holding proved the fact that he had a beautiful rhythmic runner. He was just incredibly to just glide through the crease, where Greg always used to struggle to get to the crease. So when he got to the crease, sometimes he was no balling, and that used to drive him crackers, you know. But again, as you said, a great bloke.
And we mustn't forget, of course, that here at Cardiff, here at Sophia Gardens, at the time, the pitch was still bedding in, and there was the infamous ridge. And I can remember as a youngster here, sitting in the stand and seeing Greg hit the ridge. The ball disappeared about 10 feet over Ivian's head. And I think it might have been the one occasion in my scorebook I actually wrote down six byes.
Yeah.
Mike, remembering, I'm sure... Yeah. When Hugh was batting, the ridge had long gone. But Mike, the ridge here at Sophia Gardens was something to behold.
Oh, it was frightening because the ridge, instead of going down the wicket, went across the wicket midway, sort of right the way across the square. And unfortunately, it dried up. And it wasn't a ridge; it was more like a barrel. you could actually see it, and I can remember Greg coming in, I think it was one day, and John Edrich was batting the river end. And he came in and he hit it, the near side to John. And of course, the ball went careering. I mean, up and up and up and over. And as you said, I think one of them went for six or just one bounce, four, whatever it was. But it was amazing. But the next ball John Edrich, it landed this side and it didn't leave the floor. So it shot straight along the ground. It hit John Edrich on the foot and he got given out LBW. So you had no chance of batting, let alone just sort of using the wicket itself. And he could, the wickets in those days, they weren't good at all. You really never knew when one was going to pass you a year off a length. And to have the ridge as well to contend with, it was really, really difficult, especially when he played on shirt fronts up in Edgbaston or at the Oval or at Lord's. I mean, the wicket at Cardiff was absolutely awful. No batters liked playing there at that time.
Well, of course, I'm glad to say that with all the hard work in since then of Albert Francis, Len Smith, in recent times as well with Robin Sexton here, the wickets obviously have improved and we now regularly host Test cricket, but I think it's a measure of the hard work of those gentlemen and many others to say that we have moved forward. So let's move on as well to another great to an outstanding, I think, in my own mind, the only person who you could put alongside Viv Richards as a great overseas batter, although Manus Labuschagne and Colin Ingram in a different context in the modern era. But as a young boy growing up here in Cardiff, even though the wickets were spiteful, as we just said, even though the wickets were very uneven, there was grace, there was poise, there was power, and there was Majid. And I thought Majid was magic. Mike, you batted with Majid many times. What do you remember?
Well, I think you've just covered it all, really. he was really graceful, absolutely tremendous, you know. And but when we used to talk at nets and things like that, he was one of those that actually say to you, well, you get your foot in line with the ball and you play through the line and get it as near as you can and this, that, the other. Well, when Majid went out to bat, it was like a magic wand. Sometimes his feet were never even near the ball, and yet he would absolutely cover, drive off, drive on, drive with grace and elegance. And he always had a lot of time to play the shots. All the great players, you know, like Hugh, who's here tonight, and Matthew, they had loads of time to play because they were excellent, excellent players. And Majid was exactly the same, but he did it with elegance and he was very, very quiet. And he was a really, really nice chap. But to be out there and sometimes, you know, you wouldn't be running too much in any case because the ball would be disappearing all over the place. But very, very quiet, but world-class. But I tell you, another world-class player that I was fortunate enough to play with was Javed, me and Dad. An absolutely ruthless overseas player that I don't know any bowler that would like playing against him. He could play the lot, all these spinners and all these great quick bowlers, he could take them all on. But both of those, in my eyes, were superb. But Majid, as I said, was a different type of character altogether from JJ. He really was. He was elegant, he was a Khan, he was there with authority. And he composed himself. He was a gentleman on the field, a gentleman off the field, and someone to look up to. And it was a pleasure batting the other side and just watching the way he did it.
The photo there is actually of a game in 1975 at Wellingborough School, Glamorgan against North Hants. It was televised, of course, back in the 1970s. You could turn on BBC Two at 5 to 2 on a Sunday afternoon and then wallow for the next 5 hours or so watching a John Player Sunday League game, 40 overs. And on this particular occasion, Majid, even though he'd arrived late at the ground and I think he'd got lost trying to find Wellingborough and the school, Majid went out and in 22 balls reached 50. And won the prize for the fastest televised 50 which of course was made every year. A superb, elegant player. Now, talking of fast innings, that was won by Majid. 1976, there was another one at Swansea. There's Swansea in the 1970s. And 1976, the gentleman on the right-hand side there, Clive Hubert Lloyd, Supercat, Clive Lloyd, captain of the West Indies. And in a game at Swansea, Clive Lloyd scored a double hundred in the space of just 2 hours. I know an achievement which an Iron Donald equaled up at Colwyn Bay in 2016 against Derbyshire. But here, in front of the BBC TV cameras, the games, of course, the tourist games at Swansea and the games at Cardiff broadcast live during the 1960s and 1970s. And it was at Swansea on that fateful day in August 1976. I actually remember it because I was picking up my O-level results that day. And it was memorable for me, but it was memorable as well for Clive Lloyd making his double hundred. Mike, were you lucky enough to play in that game, or were you 12th man?
I was lucky enough not to play in that game. I think I would have been 12th man that game.
Yeah, I think every bowler went around the park, and we're here celebrating the great moments in Glamorgan's history. But there is one unique achievement which this gentleman, Tyrone Powell, had, because he made his one and only first-class appearance for Glamorgan in that game in 1976 against the West Indies. He was a really promising player in New Zealand. He played representative cricket in New Zealand. He was actually born in the Caerphilly area. So he'd come over on Phil Cliff's recommendation. He scored a lot of runs in Glamorgan's second 11 before going back and living in New Zealand. But on this occasion, in his one and only appearance for Glamorgan, he was out for naught in the first innings, opening the batting, bowled, I think, by Wayne Daniel. And then in the second innings, I gather he had a stomach upset. No surprise, he was bowled by Michael Holding, again, without scoring. So in the history of Glamorgan County Cricket Club, Tyrone Powell, although he had a fantastic record in second team cricket and also a great record as well in New Zealand, his one appearance for Glamorgan didn't end in glory. Well, the 1976 game against the West Indies at Swansea was also Margit's final appearance for Glamorgan. We're not here tonight to go through all the ins and outs of why Margit left. Enough has been written, enough has been said about that. And as Mike said, Majid was a very laid-back character, a wonderful batter. We can see here often taking time to chill out in the dressing rooms. Well, the final, Majid's final appearance for Glamorgan was against the West Indies in that game when Clive Lloyd took the Glamorgan attack for a double hundred in the space of 2 hours. Remarkably, though, after having had a season in 1976 of despair, having had a season to forget, it was quite remarkable that Alan Jones sat there in the centre, together with the bulk of players there, turned things around the following year in 1977. But not this evening are we just dwelling on the perverse records like the one of our friend there, Tyrone Powell. Let's just remember the outstanding record of the gentleman on the back row there, third from the left, Tony Allen, left-arm spinner who played previously for Devon in minor county cricket. And Tony Allen played for Glamorgan in 1976 and came so close to actually winning a place on the England winter tour to India and Pakistan. In the game here at Cardiff in 1976, against Sussex, Tony Allen took 8 for 67. In both innings, he completely bamboozled Tony Gregg. And after that game, the journalists, the national journalists, were down here writing good things about Glamorgan. Tony, though, had an offer to return to his father's dairy farm, and he decided against staying here with Glamorgan. But had he stayed on, who knows? Tony Allen could have been in that Glamorgan team that played at Lord's in the final of the Gillette Cup in 1977. What I'm just going to do is I'm just going to stop the PowerPoint presentation there. And what I'm actually going to do is, I hope, show a little bit of film of 1977 and how Glamorgan, having been the whipping boys in 1976, how Glamorgan turned things round in 1977, and Mike in particular having his moment in the spotlight. So let's now enjoy some of those wonderful days of Glamorgan cricket, Glamorgan at Lord's in 1977.
After the monsoon season, we could scarcely believe our luck at Lord's today. The sun was shining down out of a cloudless sky, a day of Indian summer indeed, a full house, and a very interesting prospect indeed.
If you assess the Middlesex side, they were full, totally chock-a-block with internationals. They had Wayne Daniel, the West Indies. They had the England twins, the Edmonds and Embry. Mike Selvey opened the batting, Breers, Michael Brealey, Barlow, Gatting. It was just absolutely loaded with internationals.
Well, it really was something very, very special. It was never before had Glamorgan been to a final at Lord's. Again, in one day cricket, the toss plays such a big part. Mike Brealey won the toss and put us into bat on a morning at Lord's where it was a lovely morning, but the ball swung around a lot.
Oh. On the outside edge and a low down to slip to start with. And that's hooked away. A determined, good shot there by Alan Jones. And that's been a roar of delight to the whole flock of Glamorgan supporters who've travelled up here today.
I do remember that we did have a slow start, so I really did need to sort of get up with the pace and everything else. All I wanted to do was to keep things simple and hit the ball as straight as I possibly could.
Safe. Well, actually, didn't quite place it as he would have wanted because it went perilously close to Wayne Daniel. The timing was okay.
Good shot.
Well, that's a brave reply to starting the over at 50 for three.
Again, I could see that we were still falling behind and we needed to get on. So I then decided to concentrate all my efforts again against John Embry. I could well have been his last ball of his complete stint. So I knew exactly where I was going to hit John, hit him straight and hit him hard. But I had to make a little bit of an advanced movement with my feet.
That's a massive hit.
I struck John as I anticipated, but then the ball just kept going. and going and going.
He really has given that some clobber way into the pavilion. A terrific blow off the last ball of John Emery's 12th over.
And I just couldn't believe it. So everybody was sort of looking because it seemed to be up there forever. And it kept going and going. And then it hit. There's an MCC sign on one of the turrets. It hit that on the way up. And it bounced off of that. And I thought, and I can also remember Wade Daniel, who's looking underneath. He just turns around and looks up. And he went, oh God, he said, this is incredible. And then they had the flags waving over the scorers and so forth, and Richie Benno made a comment, and it was quite incredible. There's lots of sixes that I've hit over my career, but it was against Middlesex in the final at Lords, and all the crowd and they went absolutely ballistic, and it was a wonderful. This is a wonderful day, and the whole thing. The only sad thing is that we did lose it.
Still 2-1. Corner to Edmonds.
That should be it. He's taken the first one quickly. He's turning for the second. The mission is successfully accomplished by Middlesex. They win the Gillette Cup by the margin of 5 wickets. As the crowd stream onto the ground.
Well, Alan Jones, you may be the Glamorgan defeated captain, but you've still got a smile on your face.
Well, Peter, it was a great occasion for Glamorgan to get to come to Lords today. Of course, it's disappointing for all the players, you know, coming to Lords and losing, but somebody has to lose. But I'm grateful to the side for the way that they played cricket this year. They've played tremendous cricket. We've been a very good side in the Gillette Cup to get to the final. It's a terrific achievement, and I'm grateful to them.
Okay, a wonderful and absolutely memorable day there for Glamorgan, even though Glamorgan ended up losing by 5 wickets. I'm just checking, because we're getting a little bit of feedback from some people, so I'm just making sure that, yeah, everyone has got their microphones turned off. Great, that's wonderful. Okay, we're going to go back to the presentation, or I will do in when I click the right thing. Mike, just whilst I get the technology working again, could I just ask you then just to update on what you said then in terms of here we are, there you are playing those shots, Mike. You obviously went out with your game plan to get some quick runs, but did you target the spinners in particular, or were you just lying wait until the end of Embry's spell?
No, not really. I mean, when you're playing in one day cricket, you're just going to play every ball as it is. I'm always looking to get onto the front foot and strike a ball, and you know, because you're playing one day cricket, mind you, I used to play the same way when I was playing 3 day cricket as well, but that's another story. But yeah, I was looking to score runs as quickly as I possibly can and take it to the bowler. Don't let, you know, go to the bowler all the time and do as best you can. Sometimes, you know, I'd be sometimes too aggressive and I'd be walking down the wicket and missing one and walking straight back to the pavilion. But there were lots of wonderful times when you just get out there and the crowd enjoyed it. You know, they enjoyed me playing shots. They enjoyed coming to watch, I'm not trying to sound big-headed, but they enjoy coming to watch somebody that could strike the ball. I think everybody loved that. Not watching me necessarily, but any batsman that could go out there and attack the bowling and for the crowd to be entertained. It's absolutely wonderful. That's the way I'd like to play the game, and that's the way I hope that people can remember me by. And I thoroughly enjoyed it all along the way, let me tell you.
Absolutely. And I know there are still people in the MCC, still people at Lord's who remember that six, and you very nearly emulated the feat of Albert Trott back in the early Edwardian era by hitting a ball over the pavilion. Of course, another moment in the game that people remember was Mike Brearley edging behind into the very safe gloves of Ivan Jones, the very first ball that Malcolm Nash bowled, and Middlesex 0-1 in on the scoreboard. And Glamorgan having made around about 170, as I say, people thinking, well, maybe it's going to be Glamorgan's day. But Clive Radley dug in, survived an early chance, and as conditions dried out and the runs were ticked over by Clive Radley, he saw Middlesex to that victory. It wasn't to be for Glamorgan, but there at first slip, a man who had joined Glamorgan, the committee clearly at the time were looking to improve Glamorgan's one-day form. And Tom Cartwright there, a superb bowler, an outstanding coach, and a man who, as a coach, did so much great work for the Welsh Cricket Association in the 1980s. At second slip, Collis King, the West Indian all-rounder, who'd been a member of the West Indies team that had done so well in the inaugural Cricket World Cup as well. So Glamorgan clearly looking to boost their one-day record. And a change in captaincy occurred as well at the end of the 1970s. Robin Hobbs, the former Essex and England leg spinner, came and joined Glamorgan on a three-year contract. He was captain in 1979 before handing over to Malcolm Nash, who was then captain in 1980 and again in 1981. Now, Hugh, you were a young junior cricketer learning your trade at Blundell School in Tiverton in Devon, winning honours, playing at various England age group teams. But what was it like for you, Hugh, as someone just taking their first steps in professional cricket, to be rubbing shoulders with some of these England, former England test players, and also some of the great names in Glamorgan cricket from the previous decade?
Yeah, well, I mean, from the previous photograph, Tom Cartwright was very much my coach and mentor throughout my career, actually. Whenever I was struggling, you know, when I was a pro, I always used to go back to Tom. You know, technically, I think he was as good as anybody I've ever seen coaching. He kind of understood my game. You know, I had an enormous amount of respect for him. So I worked really closely with him, particularly through my formative years, but as I said, throughout my whole career, really. And then Robin Hobbs, I've got very, very fond memories of Robin. I mean, obviously a very fine cricketer in his day, great character. But I will always remember as a kind of 15, 16 year old, really, really green behind the ears. Robin, when particularly pre-season training, we always used to go down to Neath. Robin went out of his way to come pick me up in Cowbridge, stick my kit in his car, take me down to Neath, and he was Glamorgan captain at that stage, to pick a 15 or 16 year old up to take them down to Nets. I thought it was an extraordinary effort. And, you know, it was typical of Robin. As I say, he was a great character and someone I think, you know, loved his short time at Glamorgan.
And Mike, you, I know, enjoyed your moments with Nashy as well. In fact, what we should have said was, back in 1976 as well, I think you and Nashy were together when he hit a whirlwind 100 at the Oval against Surrey.
Oh, yeah, that was incredible. Oh, my God. Nashy was right out there in front. He loads of confidence in his own ability. And we were really, really struggling at the Oval. And, I mean, Surrey had a great attack in those days, you know, Pat Pocock, Jeff Arnold, Robin Jackman, Intikab Alam, all international cricketers, wonderful. And we were struggling in any case. I think we were four down or maybe five down. I can't remember when Nashy came in. And the first ball, he hurtled down the wicket, first ball, missed it completely, tried to hit it for six, turned round, it was the end of the over, he tapped the wicket down, he came up to me. Well, I said to him, Nashi, I said, what are you trying to do? I said, we're trying to get some runs here. He said, don't worry, Mike, he said, I'm going to get 100 today. And I think the next couple of balls, he missed those as well. So I thought, oh my gosh, we're going to be down another wicket now. But in any case, what happened was amazing. It was like a transformation. Nashi connected with absolutely everything you can imagine. And I think he had Percy Pocock, well, long and far. And anybody that was there, you know, so they could see. He was just timing it superbly well. I ran the other side and let Nashi get on with it. And it was a great innings, and it was something to behold. But he's one hell of a character, Nashi was. Absolutely brilliant.
Absolutely. And as we say, as we were saying, he had a spell 1980, 1981 as Glamorgan captain. One of the young cricketers to emerge during both Robin's spell as captain and also Nashi's spell as captain, it would be very remiss of us here on this anniversary talk not to remember Geoffrey Clarke Holmes. Holmesy, another player like you, Mike, who progressed from the MCC ground staff onto the Glamorgan staff. Of course, you'd been sent to Lords by Glamorgan. Jeff had gone there from Newcastle upon Tyne, came under the wing of Len Munster and others, and was recommended to Glamorgan. Delighted to see Matt Maynard on the call now. Good evening, Matt, and congratulations on your achievements as Welly Man Walking and raising so much money for a wonderful cause as well. But perhaps in a minute you could join in just with your memories of Jeff. But Hugh, someone who worked both on the field and off the field with Jeff, your memories of Jeff Holmes?
Like the overriding memory about Jeff, a lovely man who left us far too early. He came down from Lords, as you say, with Terry Davis and with Neil Perry, three great characters, three very different characters, but all, you know, really engaging in their own right. And Jeff was always one of those players that you wanted in your side, really wholehearted performer with bat and ball. He'd bat anywhere and pretty much did so for Glamorgan. And yeah, when he bowled his seamers with that low arm on the pitches that we had at Sapphire Gardens, he bowled very straight, very difficult to get away, and was particularly effective in one-day cricket. So, yeah, I've got nothing but fond memories from Jeff. And I said, yeah, he just left us far too soon.
Matt, good evening. If you wanted to share your memories of Jeff as well.
You touched on it there, Chalker, that, you know, such a great team man. Around everything, really, you know, so around practice, tactics, the game awareness, etc. Great help for me as my roommate for 8 years at Glamorgan. Used to bring his ketchup everywhere with him, you know, so if we'd get a bit of a takeout of an evening, ketchup would be on it, whether that was Chinese, whether it was fish and chips, whether it would be from the hotel, it was full of ketchup all the time. But he actually made a massive contribution in my first game. So during my debut, which was a three-day game against Yorkshire, we played them in the Sunday League, sandwiched in between. And Jeff had quite a remarkable game with the ball. You know, he kind of won us the game. We got boycotted out, Rodney Ontong. Jim Love, I think, smacked one back and Rodney just got a fingertip on it and ran Boych out at the non-striker's end, which he wasn't too happy about. But Jeff closed the game out brilliant for us and won us that game, you know, at the back end with his skill at bowling at the death, which, you know, he had, because his arm was so low, he actually could miss the target by a little bit and get away with it. And he was skiddy enough. It was like he hit the bat a bit harder than you thought. and a slightly unusual action. So just a great team, man, you know.
Now, Jeff and others were members we mentioned earlier on, the Glamorgan team that won the second 11 competition, did well in the under 25 competition. You mentioned Hugh Terry Davis, who's second from the right there. Rodney Ontong just behind him looking down. Alan Lewis Jones as well, another fine left-handed opening batter. Hugh, I can see you between, there's Phil Cliff pouring the champagne and Ray Bray, the erstwhile scorer. Then I can see Hugh for this publicity photo. Someone else as well who we must mention, who did an awful lot in grooming the Glamorgan talent at the time, KJ, Kevin Lyons, the second 11 captain and coach. Let's talk about Rodney Ontong briefly. You just mentioned Rodney, Hugh. What a fine, outstanding sportsman. Both someone, of course, who came over initially as a seam bowler and then switched to off spin, and someone who moved up the order and was an outstanding number three batter as well. Your memories, Hugh.
A really talented cricketer was Rodney. He yeah, as you say, he came across as a seam bowler. He used to swing the ball late, but when he turned to spin, he gave it a real rip. And in those days, particularly in one day cricket, when you could have six on the leg side, he was really, really tough to get away. And I think, hugely respected as one of the best spinners of that era. And there were lots of really good ones. And I know that certainly back in South Africa, Rodney, you know, at that time would have been very close to playing for South Africa. He actually got me my first overseas job at CBC Old Boys in Pretoria. I played club cricket with him over there. And I know how fondly, you know, they remember him there and, what he did in domestic cricket there. As I say, you know, if South Africa would have been playing international cricket at that stage, he would have been very, very close to their team.
And his career, of course, cruelly ended by a horrendous car crash in 1988 en route from Essex, I think it was, to Northampton in a car with Steve Barwick that went through the Central Reservation. Thank God both survived. Matt, your recollections of Rodney the cricketer?
Well, first and foremost, my first captain, you know, very aggressive as a player, as a kind of leader. I remember we played Notts at Trent Bridge and we were fending off Hadley, Rice, Kevin Cooper, who was the backup to it. And Rodney ran down the wicket and smacked this ball straight to extra cover, caught. He was the only man in front of square. And he just came off and said, well, at least I didn't die in the hole. Because what he meant was he wasn't just trying to bat for survival, he was trying to change the game. And then we went back a couple of years later and he got 130 and 13 for in a game there. Out-bowled Eddie Hemmings, who was had just recently kind of in and out of the England side. A magnificent cricketer, very, very talented. As Hugh talked about, spun the ball hard. He had these rubber fingers and he could really get some revs on the ball. And a batsman. But, you know, he taught me a thing or two. I remember coming in my early days, 25 for five against Middlesex, Sylvester Clark, steaming in. And I faced the last bowler though, it was a bouncer, and I just swayed it and looked at Sylvester. And Diamond, Wayne Daniel. And Rodney told me off with him between the over. He said, you know, look at your boot, son. I said, look, I'm just trying to, we're 25 for five, I'm just trying to make him bowl a bad ball. And anyway, during the next over, Rodney got a single, so it was on strike, the first ball of Wayne Daniels. And I was a bit of a cocky 20-year-old, 19-year-old. And first ball short and wide, next over, Rodney cut him for four. I said, there you go, I told you, I've got a... anyway, but proceeded to get seven for and rolls out for not too many. But now I learned a lot from Rodney in those early days, just about, you know, trying to how you kind of formulate your career and stuff like that, and innings and stuff like that, who's hugely driven. I reconnected with him not long ago, actually. He's up in Belfast now. He's got a kid out there. So, yeah, we're in contact with each other. But, you know, huge influence in my formative years, most definitely.
Now, Hugh, I do apologise. Sorry. You made your Glamorgan debut. Seems like only yesterday, but 40 years ago. Just talk us through the attack you had to face coming in to play your first game.
Yeah, it was, if I'm right, I think it was in early September of 1981, and we were playing Leicester at Sapphire Gardens, and Leicester had a strong team at that stage. Andy Roberts was playing, Les Taylor was playing, I think Gordon Parsons was playing, Paddy Clift was playing. So they had a good bowling attack. And I always remember batting at seven. It was one of the first time I'd ever worn a helmet, and the first ball I'd ever faced in professional cricket was Andy Roberts. And obviously I'd played against a number of fast bowlers in second 11 cricket then, but nothing of Andy's stature. And I always remember walking out, taking my guard and looking behind me, or looking up and seeing no one there and looking behind me, and, you know, six slips and a couple of gullies and a short leg, and thought, well, if he pitches it up, you know, I can get a bat on it, then, there's plenty of runs there. But of course, first ball I faced went straight past my nose, and I didn't have much in my half. And I always remember after that game, going into the bar at the old Sapphire Gardens and speaking to Alan Jones, who was playing in the game. And I said, blimey, Alan, I said, that was a bit of a shock. I said, you know, how do you get used to playing that pace? And his words 40 years later, I will always remember, Alan said to me, if anybody ever tells you they like playing against genuine fast bowling, he said, they are liars. And that's one of the best players of fast bowling ever. And that always stuck with me.
Brilliant. Well, Glamorgan at the time also had, and Mike mentioned him a few minutes ago, Glamorgan also had as a overseas player since 1980, Javed Miandad, I think you could call him mercurial, magical, majestical. In some books, I've seen him described as a street fighter, someone who would bat and bat almost as if their life depended on it. And in one game in particular, at this time, this is at Colchester, on a spiteful wicket at Colchester, Castle Park. The game against Essex on the final day, Glamorgan had been set a target of 330 to win. They got within 13 runs, thanks to Javed Miandad. In fact, he shared several partnerships with the lower order. And in fact, Glamorgan came in this particular game in 1981 so close to winning, all down to this one man. A magical batter, someone who was adored by the fans, the supporters, not just here at Cardiff or Swansea, but all the outgrounds, as well as the other county grounds at which Glamorgan played. Hugh, your memories of batting with Javed.
Yeah, I remember actually speaking to Graham Gooch about that innings at Colchester where that picture was taken. And Gooch, he said it's the best innings he has ever seen, and he's seen a few good ones. He said it was absolutely remarkable. By the time Glamorgan started batting in the last innings, apparently there wasn't a top on the pitch, and it spun and it spat and it bounced, and apparently it was a remarkable effort. But, I was lucky enough to bat with Javed on a few occasions, actually. And it was actually quite difficult because he was like a hare between the wickets, and running between the wickets with him was a challenge. But also, I think his expectations of everybody else were very similar to the expectations he had of himself. And I remember at Swansea playing on a difficult-ish wicket that was turning a bit against Kent very early in my career, about 83, 84. And Derek Underwood was bowling, and I was having difficulties with him, and Javid basically said, run down the wicket and hit him over extra cover against the spin. And I thought, I'm never going to do that if I'm going to be here for the next 40 years. So, yeah, his expectations of others were very high. But, I mean, he was an absolute genius of a player.
Matt, have you got anything to add?
I only played once, twice with Javid, you know, and obviously he was due to come back in, I think it was 86, and he won the Calcutta Cup, didn't he, for Pakistan against India, and he never came back. But it was just like, you got to, Courtney Walsh in one of my early games got me a bit of a going over at Cardiff, and Javid just said, you need to work on the short ball this winter. Don't look to get out of the way. Look to hit it. You'll learn when to get out of the way. And it was a brilliant bit of advice. We put on a few in that game, and I still managed to scrape the 40, but it was a very uncomfortable 40. But his advice then, again, really helped drive me on. But he was a wonderful player. I think he got hit earlier in the 95 season. I think down in Gloucester, if I'm right, I might be wrong on that. She would know. He probably playing in the game. I wasn't. I hadn't made my debut at that stage. And he came then to play a second 11 game at Usk, and he got like 130. And that's what you do, you know. If you're a first team player, you want to prove your fitness. You go and get 130 plus. You know, you get a big kind of good 100 to show that you're back in form. You're ready to go. And so a couple of lessons from Javid were important to me there.
Brilliant. Well, 1983 saw the end of Alan Jones's illustrious career. Here you can see one of the Glamorgan sponsors making a presentation to Alan. We can see the delighted Glamorgan players around. You can see Terry Davis on the right. You can see John Hopkins, Hugh, Barry Lloyd, Steve Barwick, Basil. We'll come on to him a little bit later. Alan Lewis-Jones, Charlie Rowe, Greg Thomas, Rodney, and at the back also, there's Winston Davis. Let's just talk, before talking about Winston, let's just talk about Terry. Terry Davis is a wicketkeeper. Hugh, you mentioned earlier on Terry coming from the MCC ground staff. I think I'm right in saying he was also a very talented footballer in his youth as well.
Yeah, very talented footballer. He loved his football. He was a very close friend of both Matt and mine. I shared a house with him for a couple of winters as well. And Terry, very talented gloveman, very good pair of hands. He was tenacious with the bat. I always remember it was very funny the night before we played any quick bowlers the next day, and particularly Michael Holding. He got very, very nervous ahead of that. But he was a great character, and didn't spend that much time with us, sadly. He went down to Australia, married an Australian girl, Noelle, who'd been going out for a long time. But subsequently, over the last kind of 40 years or so, he's been very successful in business. He was the number two at the South Australian Cricket Association at the Adelaide Oval. And I think the last time I'd spoken to Terry, certainly he was running one of the big stadia in, I think, Dunedin. He's been very successful off the field. But again, great character and a great team, man.
Absolutely. And I'm delighted to say that all being well in the new year, using the technology here of Zoom, we are hoping to actually have a museum catch-up with Terry Davis. As you rightly say, he's in New Zealand running one of their major, not just sporting complexes, but it's a major conference and entertainment venue. So it will be fascinating to hear how Terry has gone from keeping wicket for Glamorgan to such an illustrious position. I will be giving further information on the Glamorgan website once we know the confirmed date. I have another date at the end as well, because I've got good news. I know several people on the call this evening were hoping to have heard Matthew Elliott back in the spring. We had a few technical issues, but I was speaking with Matthew or Herb this morning, and all being well, 7 o'clock on Wednesday, the 24th of November, we'll have an evening with Matthew Elliott, And in fact, some of you may know that his son, Sam, is doing really well in Australia, and I believe is poised to make his first class debut in a Sheffield Shield game, potentially over the weekend. Well, I said we'd mention the fast bowlers because there are two fast bowlers here in the photo. On the left, Winston Davis, and in the middle, Ezra Mosley. Now, I'll get Matt to talk about Winston in a minute, but Hugh, let's talk about Ezra, because Ezra could have been, I mean, we said earlier on in the talk how Glamorgan could have had Michael Holding. Well, we did have Ezra Mosley, and boy, what a difference he made, but albeit very briefly. Of course, sadly, Ezra killed in a hit-and-run accident in the West Indies a few months ago. But Hugh, your memories of Ezra, the fast bowler.
Yeah, again, a lovely man, and it was really sad actually, because he had a very bad back injury, a spinal stress fracture, which really put pay to a large part of his career. Because certainly when he came over, we'd actually thought we signed a medium pacer to start with. He'd marked his run up in pre-season nets and literally of about 10 or 15 paces. And then just produced extraordinary speed off the shortest run imaginable, which was really disconcerting for batters. And he made a massive impression. I think I'm right in saying that in 1980, he'd taken 60-odd wickets in the first half of the summer. Glamorgan were in the top two or three of the championship. Ezra got injured, and sadly, I don't think we won another game that summer. But he made an extraordinary impact there, and it's just such a great shame that he couldn't portray his talent for a lot longer. He did obviously play a handful of Test matches later on, and did come back to Glamorgan for a half a season or so. He had real talent. It is just such a shame that we didn't have him for longer.
And Matt, Winston Davis, who came as Ezra's replacement, another great man on the field. And sadly, of course, life hasn't been very kind to Winston after an unfortunate accident, and he's now in a wheelchair. But Matt, your recollections of Winston in his pomp as a fast bowler.
Oh, just a great man, wasn't he? You know, just a great person, great man. Look, I'm not 100%, but he still may hold the best one-day figures in a World Cup campaign for the West Indies. He on his day, he would blow anyone apart, you know, just because of his obviously height. You can see the difference there between him and Ezra in the photograph. He had that house, he had that whip of his, that wrist coming through, the angle that he came from created problems not only for, right-handers, but also left-handers. And I just remember him as just a real gentle giant, really. But cross the white line, obviously a different character.
Yeah. Well, let's move on to 1985, a year that for Matt was very special. But before we talk about 1985, Glamorgan against Yorkshire at Swansea, let's talk about a few months before, where the Glamorgan game against the Australian tourists was staged at Neath. It was the first of 3 years, thanks to a superb sponsorship package with the Neath Development Corporation, a body set up to regenerate the scarred industrial landscape of the area. And what better way to promote the good things that were now in the area than Glamorgan playing host to the 1985 Australians? Hugh, were you playing in this game?
Yeah, kind of. We batted first in the game. I think it was a three-day game at the beginning of July, I think it was. And we actually lost three wickets, I think, pretty quickly. We're 30 off for three. And Javed was joined by Yunis Ahmed in that particular... Oh, there we are. I didn't even know it was coming up. Javed was and Yunis put on 370 odd for the fourth wicket, and I was next into bat, so I had my pads on for about 5.5-6 hours that particular day and never got out. But they played remarkably well again. You know, Javid just showing his class, and Yunis was obviously a very fine county cricketer.
And I've got a vivid recollection of if I just go back a slide, I've got a vivid recollection of Javid reaching his 100 by hitting a first bounce four into that green, into that yellow and white stripe marquee. And I think I'm right in saying that he actually reached his double 100 with a six over there, and a wonderful display. And of course, the Australians were going at full throttle. There were no easy runs to be had there at Neath on that day. So again, another landmark for the club with that huge partnership between Javid and Yunis. Well, Matt, Glamorgan v Yorkshire, August at Swansea. You, together with the gentleman there on your left, on the right of this photo, Phil North, you'd been drafted in to the Glamorgan team. We can see in the background as well, Mark Price, a spin bowler as well, who joined us from Lancashire. Terry Davis and Rodney Ontong congratulating you after, well, one of the finest innings I think I've had the privilege of seeing, and undoubtedly the finest innings I've ever seen on debut by a Glamorgan player. What are your memories of that that wonderful day, Matt?
Look, I'd had a taste the day before, and the Sunday league game, which I alluded to just earlier with Jeff, and we got to a stage in the game where it was set up. I didn't get a chance to bat in the first innings. The game was set up for the second innings, and a run chased by us, and we were kind of in a bit of a perilous position, really. We were struggling, so there was absolutely no pressure in terms of trying to perform and, you know, trying to do well. In those situations, I think you're quite fortunate if as a player, you can just go and play. And, you know, my old man always used to say, you see ball, hit ball kind of mentality, you know, and try and cricket as an entertainment sport. So that's kind of what I tried to do. My dad had sadly passed away the year before, and I was kind of trying to play that knock, you know, for him and for how he wanted me to go and play the game. And it kind of all came together, I suppose. And, although I'd scored very consistently for the seconds that year, I hadn't scored a century in the 3-day cricket that we were playing. I think I got 6 or 7 50s. My highest score had been 83. So when I got to 84 in this innings, then that was my highest score of the season. So it was a great start anyway. And so, well, why not go for it? You know, like that, put on 70 and chalk for the last wicket. So I got to, you know, 84, came down the wicket to Phil Carrick, 6, next ball, well, let's give it a go, he won't expect me to do it again, 6, and then he certainly won't expect me to do it again, and, you know, and thankfully I did, and
And Matt, I don't know if you can still hear us, but there was another gentleman in the match who wandered into the Glamorgan dressing room just afterwards to pass on his congratulations to you. That was Jeff Boycott. I think Matt on holiday in Northern England, I think... we've lost Matt there, but of course, not until he's told us about hitting 3 straight sixes off Phil Carrick to score 100 like that. Hugh, had you ever seen an innings like that from a debutant before?
No, absolutely not. And Jeff Boycott certainly wouldn't have done it. That is for sure. It was amazing. Yorkshire are always a good side. You never play against a poor Yorkshire side. They're always competitive. They've always got a good seam bowling attack, and more often than not, they got a couple of good spinners there as well. And it was a proper attack that they played against. And it was a remarkable effort. I mean, as Matt said, that he'd had a reasonable summer up until then, absolutely took his chance when it presented itself. And he never looked back in his career. It's a nerve-wracking time to make your debut, particularly a big game like that. And to start off the way that he did, he just carried on that for the rest of his career. And, it was a pleasure to watch Matt bat when he was at his very best, because there weren't many better.
Absolutely. Of course, also emerging at the time, and in fact, at the end of the 1985 season, he had good news that he had been chosen to play for England in the West Indies. Of course, the gentleman who I'm talking about on the screen now, Greg Thomas, someone, Hugh, who I know was emerging in the Glamorgan second team at the same time as you. And Greg was producing in the early 1980s some of the fastest spells in county cricket. He was dubbed the fastest white bowler in the world. Hugh, you must have been very pleased when Greg got the England call-up.
Yeah, look, we were all delighted, and as we always are when anyone from Glamorgan gets selected for the England team. And as you say, Greg was about a year or so older than me, but I spent a lot of time growing up with him through the Glamorgan youth team program. And he was a very, very talented sportsman, Greg, and he's a very good rugby player in his early days until he got a back injury. And he could put his hand to most sports, and he's playing golf at the moment off about five. So he's a proper athlete. But as you say, he was at that particular stage one of the fastest bowlers in the world. And I think that when England went to the Caribbean, West Indies in their pomp, it was going to be a really, really big challenge for him. But it was something that he came back with his reputation enhanced. Although England, got beaten badly over there, but he was very much a spearhead and someone we would have liked him to have played for Glamorgan for longer, obviously, but a really talented bowler.
And someone who, had it not been for an edge that was dropped in the slips, he might even have taken a wicket with his first ball in Test cricket, bowling against the fearsome opening partnership of Desmond Haynes and Gordon Greenidge. And as you say, Hugh, coming back from that tour with his reputation enhanced. Well, you then became Glamorgan captain. Rodney Ontong passed over the captaincy baton to you. Quite a challenge as a young player to come in, but obviously a huge, huge honour to lead Glamorgan.
Yeah, I mean, a huge honour and something, clearly, I'd always aspired to from a very young age. I'd been fortunate enough to captain young England sides up until that stage, and was hoping that one day, that I'd be able to lead Glamorgan. And when I finished my A-levels, I went to the Cardiff Met, as it is now, Cardiff Met University, for 3 years to do a sports science degree. Loved my 3 years there, managed to play a bit of rugby as well. Then when I finished then, my first full year with Glamorgan was 1986. And as you said, halfway through that summer, Rodney relinquished the captaincy, and David Wyndham Lewis, who was then chairman of cricket at Glamorgan, approached me kind of out of the blue, really, and said, would you like to do it? And I didn't really think about it too long. I was ambitious and hoped to do it at some stage, and I pretty much immediately said yes. I was only 22 years of age. As I said, it was my first full season. And to be frank, if I'd had my time over again, I'd say no, because I hadn't established myself in the team, really. At that stage as well, You know, you hadn't got the kind of coaching and support team the size of them that they are now. So, it wasn't just the batting on the field and the captaincy you had to do. It was all the stuff that went around it. And to be frank, I just wasn't prepared for it. And as I say, if I had my time over again, I wouldn't have done it at that stage.
Well, 1987, also the start of Glamorgan's centenary celebration, centenary of their founding as a county, albeit they're back then in 1888 as a third-class county, then becoming a minor county in 1897 before moving into the first-class world in 1921. And who better to help us kickstart our centenary celebrations of our founding than their Royal Highnesses, Prince Charles and Princess Diana. We can see there on the slide, just behind Prince Charles, the Glamorgan chairman at the time, Gwyn Craven. And just behind Diana, we can see Phil Carling, who was the secretary, and also Gerard Elias, who was on the cricket committee as well. A special game was held here at Sophia Gardens, in fact, where the marquee is in the background. Of course, that's where the pavilion is today at the redeveloped ground. And I can remember being here to see this special game, which was Glamorgan against Gloucestershire in what was called the Severn Trophy, obviously named after the river rather than the number that we see on the paddles on Strictly Come Dancing. But the Severn Trophy also gave an opportunity for Charles and Diana to meet and to mingle with the Glamorgan team. And there we can see on the front row, Jeff Holmes, as we mentioned earlier, on the extreme left. On the extreme right, we can see Greg Thomas next to John Hopkins. In the back row, we can see extreme left, very young, very debonair Matt Maynard, and also another very young and debonair batter starting to make his way in first-class cricket, Steve James. Steve had played his first game for Glamorgan in 1985 against Sussex here at Cardiff, but it got washed out and he never actually set foot on the field until 1987 when he played and shared an opening stand with Hugh. I think it was about 150 you put on against Oxford University. On the extreme right, the fast bowler, Corrie Van Zyl from South Africa. Next to Corrie, Ian Smith. Steve Monkhouse as well, a bowler acquired from Warwickshire. But I said there was a gentleman we would talk about a little bit longer, standing there immediately behind Diana. So we have the Prince and Princess of Wales at the front. Behind them, we have there the one and only Steve Barwick, or Basil, as he was known throughout the county circuit. Now, around about this particular time in 1987, Steve was switching from being a seam bowler to an off cutter, very much in the style of Don Shepherd. Matt, I don't know if you can. I see you're back on the call. I hope you can. I hope you can hear us. But your memories of Stephen Royston Barwick as a bowler.
It was terrific. He would do a brilliant job for you. You know, if you ask him to keep it tight, keep it tight. You ask him to bowl to a certain field, he'd bowl to that certain field. He had immaculate control of a cricket ball coming out of his hands. Truly, I think that during that period, you know, Don Shepherd actually was doing quite a lot of stuff with Eddie Bevan but also coaching us. You know, as you alluded to earlier, we didn't used to have a huge amount of coaching staff. So if Shep was with Eddie and stuff like this, and he had a spare hour or two, he'd come and help us. And he certainly helped Baz, and especially with his field placings and all, et cetera, et cetera. Brilliant skill he had. And he just an old fashioned pro, really, Baz. You know, he'd bowl you 50 overs in an innings and not moan about it. That was his job.
And I think it's fair to say his pre-match training regime and pre-season training regime probably wouldn't pass muster today, but you judge someone by performances on the field. And Hugh, I know maybe in a later talk we'll talk about Baz in the 1990s in the wonderful Sunday League team, but just this evening, Hugh, a few words about Baz.
Yeah, as Matt said, I mean, one of the great characters. I mean, he needed 8 pints a night to oil the wheels before he could function next day. He really was a throwback, Basil. But, you know, he was, when he was on the field, he was just an absolute joy because, as Matt said, he just didn't bowl a bad ball. The opposition really feared Basil because he actually made one or two people look really stupid. Because he could grind a game to a halt because he was so accurate. I well remember we played Lancashire up in Colwyn Bay one year, and the Lancashire team actually had a team meeting about Basil and how they were going to play him. And a very good friend of mine, my Neil Fairbrother, who was a very attacking batter, a very fine player. We played in a 4-day game just prior to that Sunday League game when they had that team meeting. And Basil bowled to Neil. Neil got stuck down Basil's end for an hour before he got off the mark. And it was one of the more pleasurable hours of my career, I have to say.
Wonderful. Well, we also had another outstanding overseas player at the time. And here we can see Ravi Shastri, the great Indian batsman and spin bowler. And I think with the wicket, you know, as we were talking about earlier on, the wickets maybe not favouring the quicks back then. To sign Ravi Shastri, or the Prince of Indian Cricket, Hugh, a huge feather in Glamorgan's cap to have Ravi's services.
Yeah, and very much the kind of brainchild of the then chair, Tony Lewis. I mean, Tony knew Ravi well from his broadcasting and... Yeah, what a great man. You know, Ravi's obviously been, you know, he's been an institution in Indian cricket now ever since he made his debut back in the early 80s. You know, and obviously is currently team manager of India during the T20 World Cup. A fine, fine player, a great man. He fitted into the change room so, so well. He loved his time in Wales. He used to drink in Sully and wanted to buy the pub there. He liked it so much, and just became part of the furniture. But you know, he was a great striker of a cricket ball with a bat. Unfortunately, when he was with us, he just lost his action a little bit, which tends to happen with some left arm spinners. He had a beautiful, easy action. Bowled the ball so easily, but just lost it for a little while, which was a real shame because, you know, a very, very fine cricketer.
Well, at the same time as well, in our centenary year, 1987-1988, Glamorgan also experimenting with floodlit matches, maybe not, certainly not as grand as the floodlit games of these days, but we had at the ground at Swansea, there were the rugby floodlights, there was an artificial wicket, and Glamorgan did play against a rest of the world team on several occasions. And it was great to see Glamorgan in their second century as a county cricket club to embrace the new technology, to move forward, and obviously something now that is part and parcel of the county calendar. Matt, I'm sorry to show you this photo. 1988, Benson and Hedges Cup semi-final against Derbyshire. Talk me through what had happened.
So one of the coolest players I thought at the time was David Gower. And he used to just wear his helmet on top of his head with earpieces, no strap. And I used to find the strap a bit irritating, so I did what he did and taped it inside. Anyway, this semi-final down at Swansea, Mikey's just dropped one a bit short. I've back foot, straight back foot punch, square, and my shoulder, as it's gone up to hit the ball, has clipped my earpiece and knocked the helmet off. as the ball's gone to the boundary for four and Mikey's turned around going back the other way, the helmet's bounced and just clipped the wicket, and you can just see that leg stump bail there on the floor. Yeah, absolutely gutted. I'd be a wealthy boy if I had a pound for every time someone said you should, you know, put a nail through that helmet and stick it to your head, you know, or something. Words like that. But it was always going to be tough because it was just getting a bit dark at that time as well, and we had a little bit of time to play with before coming back the next day. So, yeah, we kind of lost the game in that period when I got out, plus, you know, and the next 15, 20 minutes.
But your stock was on the rise, and 1988 saw you make your debut for England at the Oval against the West Indies. I don't think there were many balls. This is obviously a game at Abergavenny. Steve Rhodes there, the Worcestershire wicketkeeper. And I think that's Richard Illingworth just completing his bowling action. But Matt, your Test match debut against the West Indies at the Oval. What do you remember? Not many balls in your half.
Look, the lead up and everything like was strange, you know. So I got given a cap and a jumper, and my England cap had PRD written in it. And it was one of Paul Downton's that it was either too small for him or too big for him, and he handed back, but he'd already signed it. They'd run out the caps that summer, so I think I was the 28th or 29th player of the Jews that summer. And that was it, yeah, and it was strange. And one of the boys in the dressing room said, look, you're only keeping it that seat warm till Lemmy gets here. It was a very kind of cold dressing room to be involved in initially. And the game kind of passed me as a blur. And, you know, and that's why I've said to every person I've coached or been involved with since, take the time to enjoy the moment, because my Test debut just flew past. Not really sure really what happened. I can't recall too many things because I was kind of not in a great place, I suppose. So the advice is to slow everything down and just take everything in, really enjoy the moment. And yeah, because I didn't have a great experience on the Test debut.
Well, we'll probably cover the rest of your international career and talk as well about Hugh's international career in the maybe in the next talk coming up next month. But just to finish off things, the late 1980s. So we've seen Matt, some people say very overdue, long overdue, make his debut for England. There were many people wondering why Hugh wasn't also in the England team there in the late 1980s. But back here in Glamorgan, as you alluded to earlier on, we had two legends, undoubtedly the finest batter Wales has ever produced and the finest bowler that Wales had ever produced, Shep and Alan Jones, helping to mould the next generation. Now, the next talk obviously is going to be focusing on the 1990s. The next talk will look at those wonderful afternoons at Canterbury and Taunton when we lifted silverware. But here in the late 1980s, some of the players who made it possible for Glamorgan were cutting their teeth. We can see on the middle row there, next to Don Shepherd, we can see Tony Cotty. We can see Steve Watkin, who of course enjoyed a memorable summer in 1989 with 92 first-class wickets. We can see next to Steve Barwick as well, a man who's greatly missed by everyone here at Glamorgan Cricket. I'm talking about John Derrick. And on the back row, top left, a very youthful Robert Croft. So the next generation coming in and playing together as a Glamorgan Colts team in the South Wales Cricket Association. So Hugh, there you are as captain in between Tony Dillaway and Phil Carling on the front row. We mustn't forget as well, the two gentlemen just on the front right, Alan Butcher, signed from Surrey, and also John Steele, the former Leicestershire spinner as well. Wales, of course, for so long had been renowned for exporting steel, and here we were now importing it. And John's influence, of course, over many years has helped to groom many of our emerging players. Just to finish off then, the talk this evening, Hugh, some of the emerging faces there coming in. Who would you like to just briefly talk about to finish off?
Yeah, I mean, we felt by the time it came to the back end of the 80s, we felt that we had a really talented group of young players coming through. The one of the other ones who's not on that photograph we saw on a previous one was Steve James. I'm sure he would have been at Cambridge University when we had that photograph taken. But, you know, we felt as though that we had a core of a team, young, Welsh, talented lads, that, you know, would form the spine of the team for a long period of time. And I've always been a big believer in that, you know, if you have a strong spine, you know, you've got a good opening partnership, you've got a good number four, you've got a good all-rounder in your side, a good fast bowler, then suddenly you can pick your overseas players and one of the two other players around that. And we felt that we had the nucleus of a really good side coming together. So it was exciting. I mean, you know, we'd gone through a difficult period, if truth be known. We hadn't won a lot of games, but we knew that, you know, we had a good group of players that would that potentially for the next 10 years would look after the club.
Matt?
Yeah, it was, look, just playing and not obviously having I was just playing at those times and enjoying the camaraderie of the teammates. But you could just see that things were kind of starting to develop. I thought Alan Butcher's signing was like massive for the club, like a real key side England player from Surrey. Why is he going to Glamorgan? He still had, you know, 4, 5, 6 years left of his career, potentially. And it was a massive statement, I think, by the club. And that obviously got followed up later, 89, although Viv didn't play, but with the signing of Viv Richards, you know. And I think it was just a statement of intent, give everyone in the squad a lot of belief. And it transpired that the 90s became pretty successful and at the start of a successful period for the club.
Yep, I couldn't have said it better myself, Matt and Hugh. But let's just finish just by paying tribute there to JD, John Derrick. A man who, like the other youngsters you mentioned, emerged from club cricket. I can actually remember playing against John when I played a little bit of Morganwg League cricket, John playing for Aberdare. I can remember with his family as well. Someone who embodied everything that was good about not just club cricket in Wales, but someone who embodied everything that was good about Glamorgan cricket. A man who more often than not, would have a big, broad smile on his face. John, in 1988, won his Glamorgan cap, Hugh, and what can you remember of JD's performances that year and before?
Yeah, I mean, look, I was very close to JD. He was, you know, probably my oldest mate in cricket. We started playing Welsh schools under 15 cricket together. I always remember the very first game that we properly played together was Wales Schools v Ireland Schools at the Knoll way back in the mid-70s. And, you know, he'd been my roomie then and was my roomie during the days at Glamorgan. So I have hugely fond memories of John, you know, a lovely man. He was a terrific coach as well because, you know, he cared about people and he gave so much to the game and to young cricketers in Wales. And, you know, he was a wholehearted cricketer on the field, scored good runs, was a very steady bowler. But, you know, he was just an all round good egg and somebody that, was just a fantastic role model for young cricketers in Wales to look up to.
Matt?
Hugh's summed up brilliantly. What I will say, one of his coaching characteristics, being the most successful Glamorgan coach we've had in our history, he could work with superstars, and then he would be disciplined and real tough with the up-and-coming players about the basics and stuff. So he covered all bases throughout there, as well as working, obviously, with young kids and stuff. But he had that ability to work all the way through a squad, you know, whether it's, you know, working with the second 11 or working with the top, you know, and some egos in the first 11. He managed it brilliantly, you know, but he had the... And because he was respected by everyone who came across JD. Great man.
And Mike, you played towards the end of your Glamorgan career with a young John Derrick. You must have fond memories, Mike, as well.
Yeah, as Matt was saying. And Hugh, always remember him with a big smile on his face all the time, you know, and always very, very pleasant. He was learning his trade sort of when I came across him. And he was always open for, you know, sort of sensible advice and a very, very lovely guy. I think that's the best way to describe him. And a tragedy, an absolute tragedy, another tragedy in Glamorgan that he passed away at such a young age, along with Jeff Jones. And there's a few more as well. It's just a sad, sad thing. But all in all, I can always remember John with a massive smile on his face.
Well, thank you, Mike, for those words. My thanks as well to Hugh Morris. My thanks also to Matt for taking time out from his very well-deserved holiday.
Apologies for the signal, Chalks. We're up at Loch Lomond, hence the break up there, but...
Don't worry.
Thanks for the invite.
Well, thanks, Matt. And I look forward to talking to you again when we have the next talk, Hugh. I hope you can make it as well. And I hope many of the people on the call this evening as well. I'm just finalising dates with the rest of the panel. I'm hoping to have some of the other stars from the wonderful decade, as we've just alluded to, the golden era, the 1990s. That's our next talk. And as I did mention earlier on, we've also got an evening with Matthew Elliott to look forward to on Wednesday, the 24th of November. And I'm also delighted to say that I'm hoping just before Christmas, we're also going to have a festive celebration with Kieran Carlson and his family. So we'll be hearing from Kieran's mum and dad. And what we're going to focus on is the pathway, how Kieran came through the ranks. We're going to be looking at those very important years in the pathway and hopefully finding out how Kieran came from being at school in Hawthorne Primary School in Cardiff, then Whitchurch High, not opting to follow in the footsteps of Gareth Bale or Sam Warburton or Geraint Thomas, but to carve a niche for himself in county cricket. So it's been a real pleasure this evening to look back on the 1970s and the 1980s, two decades where there was a smattering of success, as we've seen this evening as well. There were some lows as well. But I think the key point is we finished the 1980s on a high and we continue that in the 1990s. And we'll be hearing more about that in a few weeks' time. My thanks to Mike. My thanks again to Hugh and to Matt, and my thanks to everyone else for this evening. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Diolch yn fawr, and I hope you enjoy the rest of this evening and the rest of the coming week. North Star.